As I mentioned earlier, God's word for our meditation this morning comes from our epistle reading from the book of Galatians. I will reread a couple verses for us again. But when the set time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption to sonship. This is God's word. It is said that patience is a virtue. And that is a line that I wish I would have known years ago when my sister and I decided to go snooping for our birthday presents before our birthday. So our birthdays are only a couple weeks apart, and because of that, we would often have combined birthday parties to make it easier on my parents. We would open gifts together, share a cake, all that good stuff. And about a week before the party, my anticipation was killing me. I needed to know what I was going to get for my birthday, and my sister wanted to know too. And so we went down to the basement, to the room where my mom was known to hide presents before she was able to wrap them. And sure enough, we went down. We found what we were receiving for our birthdays, and we were so excited because we knew what we were getting. But then the hard part came. Then we needed to keep it a secret that we knew what we were receiving. And so on our birthday, we would act surprised as if we had no idea what we got. And I think I maybe lasted a day before my conscience killed me so badly that I had to tell my parents what I did wrong. And so I went to my mom, I told her what I did, and she didn't yell at me, she didn't take the gifts back to the store. Instead, she did something far worse. She brought them upstairs, put them on the kitchen table for everyone to see. Every time we walked by the table, we were reminded of the bad thing that we did, felt the guilt all over again. Anytime someone came by the house and said, "What's that stuff on the table?" she would tell them what we did wrong. And then the worst part was at the party itself, when it came time to open the gifts, and there we received our opened gifts and felt that guilt all over again. It was far worse than any grounding that we could have received. But our anticipation was just too much, and maybe you've had that feeling before. I hope that you never made the same mistake I did by finding your gifts before the time came. But maybe you've had that feeling of anticipation where it was so much you just couldn't stand it. Maybe you felt it a couple weeks ago when you saw all the gifts under the tree and you just wanted to open them that instant, but you had to wait. And I hope you realized when your parents told you you have to wait until Christmas Day, if that's when you open them, that it's worth the wait to open the gifts that you have received. The people in the Old Testament had to wait to receive a gift as well. They had to wait for the prophesied Messiah to come to earth. And they waited for thousands of years, and they heard prophecy after prophecy about when this Messiah was going to come, but many of them never got to see it come to fruition. And this promise was given to Jews. It was given to God's people. They knew that this Messiah was going to come. But it's interesting that Paul writes this letter to Galatians, Gentiles, people who never held this promise and all of these prophecies for all of those thousands of years. And the Gentiles found out that unbeknownst to them, they too were living in slavery to sin, just like the Jews were. They were all in the same boat. They were all living in slavery to sin and to death. And they needed someone who was going to come and keep the law perfectly to set them free from that law. All of them were slaves to the law until someone was sent to obey it and free them from it. Being a slave to the law means that they had to wait for Christ to come and save them. But it wasn't when they wanted it to be. God's people had to wait because it was on God's timeline. And so Paul says, but when the set time had fully come, God sent his son. How were God's people supposed to know when this son would come? That's the hard part. They never really knew. They got little glimpses of when this Messiah might come, where he might come, what he might bring, but they never got specifics. From the time in the Garden of Eden when God promised that Messiah would come, God's people were mostly in the dark. So for thousands of years, they waited in anticipation. And I often wonder if they ever made guesses about when this Messiah would come. Like today, we see people guess when Christ is going to come again, when the world is going to end on Judgment Day, and so often they've been wrong. And I wonder how many times they were wrong as well, waiting for this Messiah to finally come. But in God's infinite wisdom, he kept that knowledge to himself because everything had to be perfect. The timing had to be right. If Caesar Augustus hadn't issued that decree, would Mary and Joseph have been in Bethlehem? If Mary and Joseph would have found a place in the inn to stay, would the shepherds have been able to find them? If the Magi had not received a vision from God not to go back to Herod, would they have gone straight to him and told them where the baby Jesus was so that the baby Jesus could be killed? Everything had to be perfect for God's son to come. And it's a good thing that our God was in control. And not only did the timing have to be right, but who and what Jesus did and was had to be perfect as well. Paul says he had to be born of a woman, born under the law to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption to sonship. If mankind was to be set free from the slavery of the law, they needed someone who could keep it perfectly. No ordinary man could do that, but the God-man could. Jesus had to become man in order to be under the law so that he would have to obey it. And because he was true God, he was able to obey it perfectly for us. And so through his humiliation, through his suffering, his death on the cross, he paid that price for us to be set free from our slavery. And along with receiving that forgiveness, that freedom, we have also been adopted by God. Once we were set free from our slavery to the law, God didn't just let us go to our own devices. Instead, he brought us to himself and adopted us with the blood of his son on the cross. We now are all adopted children of God, our Father. We can call the Heavenly Father our Heavenly Father. When God sent his son at the perfect time, it wasn't to torture his people and make them wait. It was to lead them to trust him and his perfect timeline. The year had to be right. The place had to be right. The context had to be right. Everything had to be perfect, and it was. And so Jesus came as our brother. He experienced every human emotion. He felt human pain, but he was perfect through it all for you and for me. And because he was able to keep it perfectly, we were redeemed and we were adopted. For many of God's people, it was a very long wait, but the wait was worth it. And so when Paul said this to the Galatians, those who grew up without this sense of a heavenly father, this was amazing news to hear for them because they found out they were loved, they were set free, and they were wanted by God. It was definitely worth the wait for them. Those who might not have come to faith until Jesus had already come and gone into heaven. And now, because the Holy Spirit was in their hearts, they now long to call out to God, their Father. And along with these adoption papers that they have received, on the back of it, it says that they were heirs of heaven. They received a heavenly inheritance. And just like the Galatians received that inheritance, so you and I also receive that inheritance. Paul says, because you are his sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. Did you notice the shift of pronouns here? Paul begins this section by saying, we and us, and now he switches it to you. Paul is making this personal. He wanted the Galatians, and he wants us to understand that God sent his Son to save the whole world, but all of these blessings apply to you individually. Through baptism, God sends his Holy Spirit into our hearts. He turned our cold, dead hearts of sin and unbelief into hearts that believe, hearts that are full of faith and good works to our Heavenly Father. And because the Holy Spirit lives in our hearts, he calls out to God the Father, because we have a Father in heaven who has done good things for us. And when we call to him as his children, he promises to hear us, just like any father hears the call of his own children. And Paul continues by saying, because of all those things, you are no longer a slave, but God's child. And since you are his child, God has also made you an heir. Paul is continuing with the personal blessings that we have received. You are no longer a slave. How? Because Jesus set you free from that slavery. Because Christ has freed you, you are God's child. How is that possible? Because Jesus' blood signed your adoption papers. You have received a heavenly inheritance. Why? Because that's what happens when we are children of our Heavenly Father. How wonderful those people in Galatia must have felt to hear this amazing news, and how wonderful it makes us feel when we hear how much our Heavenly Father loved us. That he sent his Son in a manger to die for the sake of us becoming his brothers and sisters, to be sons and heirs of eternal life. But in this lesson, Paul reminds us that we have to be patient for gifts that we can't open yet. We talked about last week, last Sunday, how God has given us the greatest gift of all in his Son, and how all the gifts we receive after that come from that first gift. And some of those gifts we can open today. We can open all of the blessings we receive on a daily basis. We can be reminded of that forgiveness each and every day. But some gifts we can't open yet. We have to wait to open our gift of heaven. We have to wait until Christ comes again. And we have to be patient. No doubt this gift has been promised to us. There is a gift for you from your Heavenly Father to you. But we just can't open it yet. We have to wait until the time is right when God calls us home to be with him. And God promises that it will be worth the wait. On Christmas, when you were finally able to open your gifts, I'm sure you were just ecstatic being able to open all the things that you asked for, and maybe things that you didn't even know you were getting. And I'm sure you haven't put your favorite one down yet. I know I haven't. But I'm sure you can tell yourself that the wait was worth it. Don't make the same mistake I did by snooping too early. It was not worth doing that. Christ has come. And now we wait for him to come again. He set us free from the law so that we could be his brothers and sisters, so that we could be set free, so that we could receive an inheritance from our Heavenly Father. And all of our names are signed in the Book of Life. that is an amazing gift that we have received, but it is a gift that we can't open yet. As God's children, we have been given gifts such as protection, love, comfort, peace. The list could go on and on. But the greatest gift we have received is our adoption to be His sons and daughters. And through that adoption, we have received heaven, a gift that's waiting for us, but a gift that we have to be patient to open. Amen. Please stand.